Hello, hello, Mordimer here, and today one more game from Magnus Carlsen Invitational 2020 tournament. I already recorded 5 videos, so if you are interested in the most interesting games, check the link over there and more games of this tournament over there. And today I would like to show you the game between Magnus Carlsen, current world champion, number one in ranking as well. He's ranking 2863, but in rapid he's also world champion and he's ranking 2881. He is also the world champion in the blitz time format, so triple world champion. And today he's gonna play as white against Maxime Vachiere-Lagrave. Both of the players are 29 years old. Maxime Vachiere-Lagrave in standard chess 2778, that's his ranking, but he is very strong in rapid 2860, and he's gonna play as black. And now just a short explanation why I called it a Magnus Carlsen Dominational in the thumbnail, because look at this. This is the table with the standings after round 4. Magnus Carlsen won all the matches so far. However, he just needed one Armageddon game against Hikaru Nakamura. He has 11 points and Hikaru Nakamura 10 points, so just behind. However, Hikaru Nakamura didn't play with the third, fourth and fifth player. So Fabiano Caruana, Ding Liren and Maxime Vachiere-Lagrave are waiting. Very exciting tournament. So far, Magnus Carlsen really doing what he wants. He dominates the tournament. Sometimes he blunders something, like he don't pay too much attention, but overall his performance is just phenomenal. So definitely the main candidate to win this tournament. And without further ado, let's jump into the game. We have d4 by Magnus Carlsen. We have d5, c4, c6, so Slav defense again. But here Magnus Carlsen goes for e3. We have knight on f6, knight on c3, and now bishop f5. But this time it's not a mistake, okay? If knight on f3, that would be the mistake. If you are interested why, check the game from yesterday. I just explained in a couple of lines, very interesting, but this makes a difference. Bishop on f5 is okay in this position. We have knight on f3, we have e6, pretty standard stuff, and now knight on h4. This is the most popular move in the position, and now bishop on g6 can be played, but here we have bishop on e4. And what white should play here? Definitely they shouldn't play knight on e4. This is not really great move, because after knight on e4, this knight is under attack, so it is a extra tempo. Knight on f3, and now bishop b4, and the position is pretty unpleasant, okay? And bishop on b2, now this knight attack the bishop pin this bishop, queen always can jump to a5, really unpleasant to play that as white. And white should dominate, should get the control over the board, but that would be, just give away all the advantage and play the passive game. So definitely that's not good move. F3 is the most popular here, and now bishop on g6. We have bishop on d2, however queen on b3 is more popular here. We have bishop on d2, now bishop e7, and here knight on g6. Still queen on b3 is played often. Knight on g6, h takes on g6, and asking for the plan to black. What you gonna play? Now you have this rook, and the rook has a semi-open file, so can be activated somehow. But also if black gonna castle, then this rook, gonna be activate normal way, so couple of more moves. So black have to decide what to do. It's possible to, in the critical moment, play something like a king on f8, and the king gonna be safe, close to the center, and the rook can be, developed somehow, but it doesn't happen often. We have queen on b3, very normal plan here, queen on c7, defending b7 square, and now we have castle. D takes on c4, bishop takes on c4, and now b5. kicking the bishop, pretty standard stuff. We have bishop on e2, and now a6. So the plan is like in the Meran defense of the Slav, when a6 defending b5, and then c5 is possible. Okay, so that is the plan now. Now look at white. White has the king on the c file, so it looks like pretty dangerous. So for now, Magnus Carlsen play knight on e4. It's still a theory, you know, it's still a lot of games in the database. Knight on e4, still fighting for the c5 square. And now, knight b on d7 is the most popular and probably the best for black. And after king on b1, rook c8, h4, c5 is pushed, and then knight on c5, d takes on c5, and queen g3. And black stands really, really great, okay? This pawn is attacked twice. This pawn is also attacked. Queen also can penetrate the second rank. This pawn gonna fall, and black stands pretty good here and can choose what to play. So definitely a great line for black. But Maxime Vachiere-Lagrave didn't go for this line. He goes knight takes on e4. We have f takes on e4 and now c5. King on b1, of course, and now knight c6. And this is a very interesting moment in the game, because now this pawn is attacked twice, okay, by the pawn and by the knight. So white should do something about that. So in database, most people play something like queen on c3 or d5, okay? So queen on c3 is obviously supporting the pawn. D5, we could have e takes on d5, e takes on d5, knight e5, and the game can continue. It's quite dynamic, it's quite asymmetrical. White gonna have this passed pawn, but it's not easy to push it in the center. So definitely very interesting game can occur. But here Magnus Carlsen play e5, okay, e5. So he put his pawns on the dark square, so lower the mobility of the dark square bishop of black, also controlling the squares in front, and black has to decide now what to do. And Magnus Carlsen expected something like castle and then play h4. Engine doesn't agree totally, but let's see what could happen. So for example, c takes on d4, now h5. So the attack looks pretty dangerous. So g5, maybe h6, g6, now rook on c1, pinning the knight, rook a on c8, now e takes on d4, and now knight d4 with attack on the queen. That could be quite interesting. So for example, queen on e3, queen on d7, defending the knight, and now the position, you know, it's very favorable for a Stockfish. However, I'm not sure how many players would be comfortable with the pawn on h6. If Magnus finds some creative way to exchange this bishop, there would be no defender of the dark squares, and the queen even can come somehow. You know, there are some mating ideas here. Definitely a dangerous position for black, especially in the rapid time format. However, Magnus Carlsen said also a c takes on d4 is losing the game. That's not really true, but definitely white gonna have much easier and better game. So bishop on f3 was played. E takes on d4 cannot be played, of course, because knight on d4 and black is winning. So for example, queen on e3, defending this pawn, otherwise this pawn would fall. But then queen c2, king a1, knight e2, just exchanging the pieces. Now rook d8, and look how dangerous these pins are, okay? The queen is not protected. Rook h on e1 also doesn't help much, because simply rook h2 winning just another pawn. And if white want to, you know, get out of the pin and exchange the pieces, black of course gonna do it. Just exchange everything here. Rook on e2, and look at this. Black just dominate the position, have two extra pawns, and definitely gonna have very comfortable and easy win. So not this way. Bishop f3 has to be played, okay? So this is what Magnus play. We have a rook on c8, and now rook on c1 as planned. So this knight is pinned, okay? And now queen on c2 is coming. What to do? How to defend the knight? Do you have any ideas? What would you play as black in this position? It's a pretty dangerous position, so you have to be very precise. What moves do you have? King on d7, bringing extra defender. It's of course losing. Bishop c6, and you lose the minor piece. And if you take, it's even worse. You just exchange the pieces. You have queen for the rook, so definitely easy win. What else can be played? Queen on b7. Yes, you are not pinned this way, but now you are pinned this way. So it also doesn't work. Okay, simply rook on c2. And after, for example, castle, you're gonna lose the minor piece again. So it doesn't work as well. Queen on b6 looks the best here, okay? And for example, now queen on c2 just doesn't work because of the castle connecting the rooks, which is very important. And now if bishop takes on c6, now d on e3, it's pretty good idea. And now, if white can play, you know, take the sacrifice the bishop, that's the one way of playing. And if not, then bishop e1 and black is winning. Rook c7, blacks are not in hurry. Now it's opposite situation where this queen is behind the pinned piece. So very bad. Queen on e4 and, for example, rook fc8 and then winning back the material and winning the game. For example, bishop on g3, rook on c6. Now just exchange the pieces and let's see what's gonna happen here. It looks like a pretty okay. Bishop on f4, e2, and now rook e1. Rook c4 attacking the bishop. Now bishop has to be moved. Rook e4 defending this pawn. And what to play now? Bishop on b4 is coming. So that would be disaster. A3 have to be played. Now b4, what do you play now? King on c2, bishop a3, and now king d3, rook b4. And yes, white can win this pawn, but black already have another passed pawn, and with two extra pawns, definitely gonna win this game. So not this way, rather e takes on d4. And now castle connect the rooks, queen on c2, which looks pretty dangerous. So black would have to choose something. Knight on e7, not really great. Queen on e4, and white have very comfortable game here, okay? The material is equal, but white just dominate the position. Now d5 is coming, so I can exchange this weak pawn, and with the pair of bishop, white really can enjoy the game. But more interesting line would be if a black goes for knight on e5. But it's difficult, of course, to find. But the idea is to, you know, take the pieces on the way and the last time with the check. So here white actually have the only one way to win, queen on c8. Okay, this is the only way. And now can't play something like rook on c8. This is definitely losing, because after rook on c8 we have the extra minor piece, and of course that is the winning. So what would have to be played is knight on f3 with this idea I show you. And now queen have to just retreat to defend. Queen on c2, knight d2, queen d2, now bishop f6. Black gonna win this pawn, and with two extra pawns can try to fight for a draw with the down the exchange. But that's possible with the queen still on the board. I think it's still possible even with two extra pawns. There are a lot of options to draw, so definitely that would be hard against Magnus Carlsen, but it's still probably the best option in this position. However, what Maxime Vachiere-Lagrave played here is queen on d7. he played queen on d7. Not really the greatest moves. We have queen on c2 by Magnus Carlsen. And now, not much choice here. There is the only one move, knight on a7. And here, queen on c8. And now, Maxime have to decide how to exchange. If queen on c8, this is possible. And after rook on c8, knight on c8, that would be the position. Where material is equal, but white have, you know, this dominating pair of bishops, and also the position is much more active for white, so probably that would be easy win for white. Maybe not easy, but that was possible. But here Maxime Vachiere-Lagrave said, okay, I want to have more active pieces, and he play knight on c8. So we have bishop on c6, we have knight on b6, bishop on d7, king on d7, we have e takes on d4, and knight on d5. Very nice outpost, because this knight can't be eliminated. However, the problem is it's completely dominated by the bishop. Okay, it can't really jump anywhere. So for now, everything is okay. And here, white have to decide what to do. The king, black king, is quite well placed, controlling the squares on the open file, and also this knight controls c7. So this is not the way to start. What white can try to play is, for example, rook c2 f1 and put the pressure on f7, which is quite okay, especially with the pawn on e5. So Maxime probably would have to do something about this, maybe move the pawns, and that would also make them vulnerable. So this was the one of the plans. However, here Magnus Carlsen play absolutely the best move, and he play h4. So he asked Maxime, what are you gonna do? I give you the pawn, are you gonna take it? And Maxime take it, and he cannot take it with the bishop. He has to exchange the rooks. If he takes with the bishop, the problem is g3, okay? And the bishop gonna fall, and with the extra rook, it's of course winning, okay? If the bishop is moved, then of course rook on h8 gonna fall. So not an option. This is why we had rook on h4, winning the pawn, but exchanging also the rook. We have rook on h4, bishop on h4, and now rook on h1. And starting the journey of the rook. So rook gonna attack the a pawn from behind. This is just incredible idea. And Magnus Carlsen often says in many, many lessons that it's try to be as much creative as you can. So this is definitely one of these creative ideas. What black can play? If play something like bishop on f2 and try to counterplay, get these pawns, yes, it's possible, but actually it's exchanging these two pawns for these three pawns. So for example, rook on f1, bishop d4, now coming with check. And then just taking these two pawns, and of course the position of white is even better, because now we have exchange extra and the same amount of pawns. So black has some passed pawn, but also white have the passed pawn. So definitely not the greatest idea. What Maxime Vachiere-Lagrave did is bishop on e7. So he want to defend that. Now it's possible to do. Magnus Carlsen continue his plan, but he don't go to h8. He goes first to h7. That is the idea. Now we have bishop on f8, defending g7 pawn, and now rook h8. We have king on e7, and now this bishop is totally locked. It has no space to go. So now Magnus Carlsen just start to centralize the king. King on c2. And Maxime just calculated, okay, that's completely losing. So I have to do something. Let's go for f6. We have e takes on f6, g takes on f6, rook h7. And in this position, Maxime Vachiere-Lagrave resign the game. And he resigned the game because he gonna lose these pawns and he cannot do anything about that. For example, king on d6, rook a7, and you can't just defend. If you try to defend, then we have this beautiful skewer winning the material and of course the game. So this is why in this position MVL just resigned. So congratulations to Magnus Carlsen. He's really dominating this tournament. That was game three. First two games were drawn, then Magnus just won, and in the last game he just had to draw. But Alexander Grishuk that just said that Magnus Carlsen trolling his opponent, and it's like you knock down your opponent but you're still hitting him, and at the end that was a draw, but Magnus Carlsen won the match. And but he shows how strong he is, and there are also some people saying that this is a Machiavelli plan to scare the candidates who gonna challenge him next year, that just to show how strong he is. So that's a very interesting idea. Okay, thanks for watching, and if you like this video, press like. If for some reason you don't like, press unlike. And if you want to see another video from Magnus Carlsen Invitational 2020, let me know in the comments which one. And yeah, thanks for watching, and see you in the next one.